Those soldiers were redeployed somewhere else, presumably to find the girls.
So there's been a violence regularly, as you say, even daily. But the case with the kidnapping of the girls clearly ratcheted things up there as well, right?
Yes, it was the most emotional attack, I think, of the entire Boko Haram insurgency. It has galvanized the public here in a way that I've never seen. There's been protests all over the country, and everyone is getting behind demanding that these girls be found.
And do you sense that that pressure is having an impact on the government?
I think it very much is. I can't imagine why President Jonathan would have accepted help from the U.S. if there wasn't so much pressure at home to accept it.
So, John Temin, what has been the relationship in the past, up to this point, between the U.S. government and the military in Nigeria?
Generally a friendly one, but I think the U.S., like many others, has been encouraging the Nigerian government to be more serious, perhaps more forceful, in the response to Boko Haram. There are a lot of security concerns associated with Boko Haram, including potential linkages to other extremist groups further north in the Sahel, even elsewhere in Africa. But the U.S. recognizes the big importance of Nigeria on a global scale. This is the largest country in Africa by population, now the largest country by economy as well. Also a major oil producer. So there is a strong linkage between Abuja and Washington.
Well, so if I ask you what the U.S. interests are in this particular case, it's things like that?
Yeah, in the particular case of these girls, I think it's a humanitarian interest more than anything else. But in the bigger picture concerns with Boko Haram, there are real security interests at stake.
Well, so Heather Murdoch, how much is the outside pressure? You were just talking about what's happening, the pressure inside the country, but pressure from outside, attention from the world. How much is that affecting the situation there?
I think it's affecting the situation a lot. I believe that the pressure from inside Nigeria is part of the reason why there's been so much attention paid by the international community. Because prior to this, the Boko Haram attacks didn't always draw a lot of attention within Nigeria. And people are talking really loud. Activists are going out of their way to make sure that this stays in the news as long as it can. And I think that's part of the reason why it's in the news internationally. And the Nigerian government is feeling the pressure from outside as well as in.
And what more are they being asked to do in terms of militarily send more people into these areas? What do you see that kind of action happening yet?
They say they are doing everything they can. Part of the problem here, though, is that they won't give us details about what they're doing. They say that they can't give details for security concerns, which is legitimate, but a lot of people want to know more. There is also word from the area that a lot of these areas the military can't even get into, which leads people to believe that maybe some of these areas aren't even controlled by the government. They're controlled by the militants.
Do you, John Temin, have a sense from people here that the government and military could, in fact, do more, but they just simply are not?
Perhaps, but I think one of the really important points here is that it can't just be a military response to the Boko Haram insurgency, because so much of this is driven by poverty, is driven by lack of jobs, lack of opportunity in northern Nigeria. I think the message from here and from a lot of the world is that there has to be an economic program to accompany some of the military responses, and that just the military response is potentially counterproductive. We've seen a rather heavy-handed military response, and that could be driving people even closer to Boko Haram in some places.
And Heather Murdoch, finally, let me just ask you, what is the thinking there now about the whereabouts, the safety of these girls?
Well, the president says the girls are safe. People are skeptical, to say the least, and the people have reported that the girls have been separated. Some of them might be over the border in Cameroon or Chad, and they're generally believed to be in the area of the Sambisa Forest, which is considered one of the most dangerous parts of the country, if not the most dangerous part of the country.
Do you have anything to add on that, John Temin?
Just that I think we also now need to be looking across some of the borders, because there are three countries nearby, Chad, Cameroon, and Niger, and it may well be that some of the girls may have crossed some of those borders. That's where intelligence sharing and cooperation between Nigeria and those countries is particularly important.
John Temin here in Washington, Heather Murdoch in Nigeria. Thank you both very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next, we turn to the latest in our series, Parenting Now. Last night, we focused on concerns about raising girls and the ways our culture shapes their identity. Tonight, we turn to questions about the challenge of raising boys.
Please get up and get your computer and come quietly back to your seat.
In the classroom, it has long been a given that girls perform better than boys. But that academic achievement gap has now widened beyond elementary school to high school and college, where experts are increasingly concerned that boys are falling behind. When it comes to test scores, girls have essentially closed the math gap with boys, but boys have not closed the reading gap with girls. Reading scores show girls 7 points ahead by fourth grade, a difference that grows to 10 points by eighth grade and remains there through high school. Boys also lag when it comes to grade point averages, and in every state, they drop out of school at a slightly higher rate. By the time they get to college, 57% of all bachelor's degrees are being awarded to women. For boys who are poor and of color, the situation can be profoundly worse. Black boys in public schools score almost 30 points lower on reading and math than white boys by fourth grade. They account for one-fifth of all school expulsions. And dropout rates for Latino and African American boys are substantially worse. Tiroya Jackson, who dropped out of high school in Washington, D.C., is raising a two-year-old son. She says she realizes that education must be a higher priority for her child.
I'm very concerned, you know, for him, especially in this day and age, especially with him being an African American, you know, male, and just today, period. You know, it's crazy.
Statistics are only part of the story. Educators, psychologists, and child welfare experts are also concerned about the messages that boys get about masculinity.
Stop crying.
Stop with the tears.
Don't cry.
That's the focus of an upcoming documentary called The Mask You Live In. Its trailer was a viral hit.
In good times, guys are like really close to each other, but when things get a little bit worse, you're on your own.
From middle school, I had four really close friends. Once I kind of went into high school, I struggle finding people I can talk to because I feel like I'm not supposed to get help.
As government-sponsored programs like the White House initiative My Brother's Keeper begin to shed a light on what's happening to boys, parents are on the hunt for solutions. So do these issues make it harder for parents to raise boys? For that and more, I'm joined by Michael Thompson, author of It's a Boy and Raising Cain. He's a psychologist specializing in the emotional health of boys. Christina Hoff Summers, author of The War Against Boys, How Misguided Feminism is Harming Our Young Men. She's a resident scholar at the American Enterprise Institute. And Ashanti Branch, vice principal at Montera Middle School in California and founder of the Ever Forward Club, an after-school program that helps minority boys succeed academically. Christina Hoff Summers, in a world that is ruled by men, why are we worried about boys?
Well, it may be ruled by men, but boys are not in charge in school, and they're falling seriously behind girls with no end in sight.
Why do you think that is?
I think it's complicated. It turns out that broken families have just a far worse effect on a young man's educational prospects. We didn't know that. We're now learning it. Secondly, I think that our schools have become very accommodating to girls, almost places where, I think it was Michael Thompson that said, the girls are the gold standard and boys are treated sort of as defective males. And we have to meet boys halfway. They're different. We have to acknowledge that boys and girls are different. They have somewhat different needs. And I think we're doing a fairly good job meeting the needs of girls, and boys have been left behind.
Michael Thompson, let me ask you about that gold standard comment. Is it true that girls are the gold standard? And if so, what are the obstacles that are being placed in the way of boys?
Look, by school age, 3/4 of boys are more physically active and more impulsive than any girls in the class. It's very hard for teachers not to wish that the boys were a little bit more like girls and they could sit longer, especially when teachers are under pressure to produce results in high-stakes testing. And so the inclination is to make more seat time, more pressure, less recess. And so they punish boys by taking recess away. They don't let them move. And then all of a sudden, we have an epidemic of ADHD with boys who are feeling like school is jail and that they're constantly in trouble.
Ashanti Branch, let me give a real time check.
You are dealing with boys every day. You're in the classroom, have been for more than a decade. How much of this issue is academic and how much of it is emotional, and or are they the same thing?
You know, I worked high school teaching math for 10 years, and I realized that there was something happening. I never really knew why the young men seemed to have such a challenge with the spatial issue, with the sitting still and focusing. But I realized I went through a training called Boys and Girls Learn Differently. And from there, learning how the brain differences are happening between boys and girls helped me really become clearer about how that worked. You know, doing the work after school program and doing the mentoring, that's a different type of style. So we always do fun first. We do fun so they can get all the energy out. Then we can sit down and talk about things. But as a math teacher, it was a very different interest. Right now at a middle school, the boys are getting in trouble a lot more often. They're definitely having a lot more challenge with focusing and disturbing others and bothering each other.
Mr. Branch,
there's a lot more challenges for them.
I'm curious whether part of this is that boys are rewarded for among each other for literally being too cool for school, for not being that invested or thinking there's much reward in academic achievement.
You know, when I started the program, it was for that reason. It was I had smart boys in my class who were failing. And I said, why are you all failing my class? Like, I'm here for you to be able to be successful. And they thought that. They said, well, you don't get respect walking around with a big, heavy backpack. That's not cool, right? So if you're going to be cool, you got to act certain ways, and you can't be too smart. And so we began to just try and figure out strategies for them to be able to not only be successful, but also feel like they were being cool to who they were trying to impress, which were most times the girls.
Christina Hoff Sommers, you, in your book or your article about this and your writing about this, you have said feminism is to blame. What do you mean?
Yeah, that was a bit of a misunderstanding because I said how misguided feminist policies have harmed our young men. I didn't mean to impugn feminism, and I think people thought that's what I was saying.
Well, tell me what you did mean.
What I did mean is that there were that women's groups organized, and they rallied around girls in areas where girls genuinely needed help, math and science, and a lot of what they did was very good. But at the same time, they carried a message that, oh, boys aren't in trouble. The patriarchy has their back. They're fine. They weren't fine. And so boys were neglected. And so it was a misguided application of feminism, not feminism itself, misguided. And the idea it's almost sometimes there are some women's groups that gave the idea that, oh, well, there are two teams, the men's teams and the women's team, and we've got to root for the women. Well, I think that we're all in this together.
Who was doing the neglecting? You say boys were neglected. Was it being done in the classroom? Was it being done at home?
Well, I think there were certain groups, the American Association of University Women. I don't want to impugn them because they did a lot to help girls, but they sort of covered up the problems of boys. I think when we first discovered how salient gender is in education, we did a good job addressing the girls' issues and neglected the boys.
Michael Thompson, let's talk about that because this series is about parenting, and I do wonder what parents' role is in this underachievement we've been talking about.
Grandparents tell me all the time that they hadn't understood how hard it was for boys in school until they had a boy. Moms were telling me this. Boys often feel that school is set against them. And by second or third grade, they've taken their soul out of school, and it's with their town team, the thing that their father comes to watch. And they think, all right, I can be a boy and a man outside of school, but school is going to pin me down and make me feel bad. I had an educator tell me boys in 1,000 years would never have invented school. But what goes on in the subject matter is always interesting to them. So we have to find a way to use teamwork, movement, competition, a public product. We have to get boys up and energized. There are too many teachers who worship the quiet solo learner, you know, who puts a nice border around the paper and hands it in and wants to please the teacher. Boys are often pleasing themselves, that is pleasing their group. And so if you can get boys to work as a team, if you can get them to compete, they are more energized and they'll do better academically. People say, well, boys don't like to write, but they'll write a screenplay and film it and show it. They'll do that with great enthusiasm.
Ashanti Branch, is that your experience as well?
Yeah, absolutely. I think what's happening in a lot of the classrooms is that students are, definitely the young men, they are fidgeting and they're moving and they're making noise because their desk is crickety. And so therefore the teacher is feeling like, why are you disturbing the rest of the class? And they're just, their bodies just don't want to sit still. And I think that one of the challenges is that the teacher says, be still, and their brain is saying, I need to move. And that's a hard battle right there. That's a battle. As an educator, when I'm in a meeting for longer than an hour, I need to move. So for students, for these young ones who are, their brains are moving, developing very fast, their bodies are ready for a lot of energy, and to be able to be sedentary is driving them up the wall, and which is definitely creating a challenge with the teachers. And then they come to my office, and I'm like, well, what happened? And he said, well, I fell out of my seat, right? And so it's like all these things that are happening with them is things that we got to find a way of supporting them in the way they learn.
How much of this is exacerbated, Christina Hoff-Summers, by the growth in single-parent families, by absence of fathers in this?
Yes, an excellent study by a think tank, Third Way. It's conservative and liberal researchers coming together to find solutions. And what they found was that in a family with a single mom, for some reason, the girl is inspired. The mother is her role model. Now, boys love their moms, but the mom is not the role model. And so he tends to turn away and withdraw. And what happens is we have a large and growing number of boys who are alienated from education. They don't have male role models to emulate. They tend to go with their peers. And so that's just another dimension of the problem.
Michael Thompson, if I'm a single mother or a married mother trying to raise a boy, what are the tips you give to try to get around some of these pitfalls?
Well, first you have to trust boy development. Boy development is slower than girl development. Girls are heads, obviously, especially in early adolescence, and boys are taking longer to catch up. But if you can ignite their enthusiasm and their passion, they will do work for you. If you constantly discipline them, suspend them, expel them. And we have a lot of evidence that the zero tolerance policies fell very heavily on boys, and they didn't help. So we have to get more teachers who are good with boys, and that can be women, but it would be helpful if we had more men in school. It would be helpful if we had more programs for fathers to come into school. But we also have to teach people that boy development, their activity, and the kind of stories that they love, the kind of adventure and science fiction and superpowers that they love, are not dangerous and not leading to violence. There are too many people who think that everything boys seem to love is dangerous.
Michael Thompson, Christina Hoff-Summers, Ashanti Branch, thank you all very much for an interesting conversation.
Thank you.
Thank you.
There's more from Michael Thompson online. He and author Marie Rocker Jones put together 10 tips for helping boys achieve their academic potential.
Finally, to the civil war in Syria, as a human toll keeps mounting there. The leader of Syria's main political opposition group comes to Washington with a plea. Chief Foreign Affairs correspondent Margaret Warner has the story.
As Syria's civil war enters its fourth year, with more than 150,000 dead and nearly 10 million displaced, the balance seems to be tipping in favor of Bashar al-Assad's forces. Rebels began withdrawing from the old city of Homs today after a year under siege. And Syrian President Assad has set presidential elections for early June. Rebels still control swaths of northern and eastern Syria, but they are splintered, and some of the strongest are extremists with ties to al-Qaeda, including a group called the Islamic State of Iraq and Syria, or ISIS. It is those ties that the Obama administration has cited as a reason for not openly arming the Syrian opposition. But recently, some moderate rebel units have been filmed using heavy anti-tank weapons with American markings. Their source is unclear. The chief moderate political force opposing Assad, the Syrian Opposition Council, composed chiefly of exiles, is headed by Ahmad Jarba. Monday, the State Department announced it was granting the SOC enhanced diplomatic status here.
The coalition has built an inclusive and moderate institution that has demonstrated its commitment to serving the interests and needs of the Syrian people, rejected extremism, and worked to advance a negotiated political transition in Syria.
The U.S. also announced $27 million more in non-lethal aid for SOC initiatives inside Syria. Jarba is in the U.S. for his first official visit. I spoke to him this morning.
President Jarba, thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
Today, rebel fighters are leaving Homs, which was a center of the revolt against Assad early on. U.S. officials are saying things are trending in the wrong direction in Syria. Are you losing ground on the battlefield?
Homs is the capital of the Syrian revolution. The people of Homs are real heroes. They have paid the bill for freedom. Homs has been under siege for more than a year and a half. No food or water or medicine was allowed inside. The siege became lethal. We want the civilians and the fighters to get out of Homs safely so their lives could be saved. This battle and this war has sometimes advances and sometimes retreats. Sometimes we might lose ground, but our people, the Syrian people, are determined to win at the end and gain back the ground that we are losing.
And what about your battle on the other front against the more extremist rebel groups? Are you losing ground there as well?
The answer is no. Originally, this land was liberated by our sons from the Assad forces, and then ISIS came over and took over these areas. In December last year, we started war against the ISIS. The battle is still ongoing. We were able to take four major provinces from ISIS, and the other provinces, the ISIS is still there. The war against ISIS is continuing, and we are winning in that war.
The United States and the West has been saying for 3 years now they want to support the moderate Syrian opposition. What has their assistance amounted to in tangible terms?
The United States is a main ally to the moderate opposition and the coalition. With the core group of Friends of Syria, it helped us politically and also helped on the humanitarian level, with a lot of aid being provided by the United States, medicine, food, healthcare, education. We are looking forward to more cooperation and enhancement of United States aid.
You have been urging, though, a lot more in the way of military assistance to the rebel fighters. Are you disappointed in President Obama and the policy he's pursued on Syria?
On this, my first official visit, we are looking forward to getting support in all aspects, including the military. The United States has a big interest in saving the Syrian people and the region. Syria is important geopolitically, and after 3 years of war, I think that additional support from the United States will be a key factor in opening a window for resolution.
Is that what you plan to tell President Obama if and when you meet him and his national security team, that you would like to see the U.S. provide more weapons, more training, more sophisticated weapons to the moderate rebel fighters on the ground?
Yes, for sure. We are going to talk to our friends in transparency, frankly, and we are going to ask for additional support. I think that the situation now is suitable for additional support in that particular area.
President Obama, 10 days ago in Manila, defended his policy on Syria. He said, critics are saying I should have bombed to get rid of chemical weapons in Syria. Well, we're getting rid of chemical weapons without bombing, and that the American public has no taste for more wars and military engagements anywhere. What do you say to that?
When the United States threatened to strike the regime quickly agreed to deliver and hand over the chemical weapons. So this gang, the Assad gang, doesn't know anything other than the language of force. If the United States and President Obama had not threatened with force, Assad would not have handed over his chemical weapons. But I want to be clear on something. We don't want our friends in America to enter any war in Syria. We don't want your American sons to come and fight in Syria like Iraq and Afghanistan. We just want the weapons to defend ourselves. The Assad regime is dropping barrel bombs on civilians, on our people, killing hundreds of people every day, and we don't have any weapons to confront that. Again, we don't want the United States to send its sons or its warplanes to fight in Syria. We just want weapons to defend ourselves.
The Obama administration, Secretary Kerry, were putting great stock in these Geneva peace talks that took place in January between the two sides, and they failed. Is that track essentially dead?
Geneva failed because of the regime's non-cooperation. Now the process has failed. Maybe you can say that it is dead, especially after Assad announced that he was going to hold presidential elections atop the skulls of the Syrian dead.
Then where's the chance for a political resolution here, or isn't there one?
I believe, yes, for sure, there is a political solution, and we have to find a political solution. If the pressure on the ground is not there, Assad will not cooperate for a political solution.
Meanwhile, the humanitarian disaster goes on. You have 200 people on average dying every day. If you step back and look at this region, Lebanon went through a 15-year civil war. Iraq, you could argue, is just redescending into what's turning into a 10-year civil war. Is that what may lie ahead for Syria?
The Syrians took to the streets for freedom and in order to build a democratic, pluralistic state. Now, the only solution should start by the Assad family stepping down from ruling Syria.
But they're unwilling to do that.
Syria is a beautiful country. It has multiple races and ethnicities and religions, Christians, Muslims, Alawis, and Druze, living together for thousands of years until this regime took over. If our friends had not let us down, the war would not have dragged for all these years. I am not afraid that the war will drag for years and years more if our friends stay with us and support us to put real pressure on Assad to accept the political solutions. I can confirm now, if Assad goes, and when Assad goes, 85% of Syria's problems will be over.
President Jarba, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Again, the major developments of the day. The chair of the Federal Reserve, Janet Yellen, told Congress the U.S. economy is on track for solid growth this quarter, but the job market is still far from satisfactory. Russian President Vladimir Putin called for separatists in eastern Ukraine to postpone a planned secession vote. He also said Russian forces have pulled back from the border, but NATO and the White House disputed that claim. And in Nigeria, police reported Islamist militants killed at least 125 people in a remote village early today. The attackers were from the same group that has abducted more than 270 girls.
On the NewsHour online right now, the Earth is losing more than 10,000 species every year. But also endangered are the scientists who name and catalog new ones. Read about what's causing this shortage of taxonomists on our science page. All that and more is on our website, newshour.pbs.org.
Yesterday's report on raising girls in a princess-dominated world sparked a lot of comments from viewers like you. One visitor said, a lot of girls enjoy being princesses, as boys love investing themselves in masculine archetypes. This is a healthy expression of their psyche and a good exploration of who they are. Another wrote, equality means letting your daughter want to be a pink princess or a lion tamer. Just let her know the options are there. I played with Barbies and G.I. Joes, and now I love sparkles and sports. Pink isn't girly, and girly isn't bad.
But there were a number of other reactions. One of you wrote us, how to raise a daughter. Easy. We wade in the creek instead of watching television. We read books and discuss the books. We go canoeing instead of shopping in the mall. And here's another. Let her do whatever she wants. But remember that people want what they see. If you don't watch commercial television, you won't see commercials. That works for me. If you'd like to see more comments or write your own, visit our website or Facebook page or tweet us back at NewsHour.
And if you want to wear pink while you're wading in the creek, that's okay.
Why not?
And so that is the NewsHour for tonight on Thursday. Our parenting series continues with the cost of kids. Paul Salmon reports on the high price of child care. I'm Judy Woodruff.
And I'm Gwen Ifill. We'll see you online and again here tomorrow evening. For all of us here at the PBS NewsHour, thank you and good night.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by...
When I was pregnant, I got more advice than I knew what to do with. What I needed was information I could trust on how to take care of me and my baby. United Healthcare has a simple program that helps moms stay on track with their doctors and get care and guidance they can use before and after the baby is born. Simple is what I need right now.
That's health in numbers. United Healthcare.
BNSF Railway. Charles Schwab, proud supporter of the PBS NewsHour. And by BAE Systems, inspired work.
and by the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation, supporting science, technology, and improved economic performance and financial literacy in the 21st century.
And with the ongoing support of these institutions and foundations. And
this program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
PBS.
MPT is pleased to bring Maryland viewers the NBC4 Democratic gubernatorial debate live from the University of Maryland. Please join us for this important Public Square special tonight at 7.
This is Public Square on member-supported MPT.
Push it out of the way.
A lot of people don't understand that when you see dead bodies, when you kill people, when you see children being killed, when you see a lot of this stuff, you're never gonna be the same.
Go! Come on, come on, come on!
That really got to me. I had never lost somebody that was close to me like that.
He was gone. My whole world just shattered right there.
No one comes back from war unchanged. Some wounds are visible. For others, they are etched into our souls.
You're never gonna get past it. You just have to decide if you're strong enough to live with it.
2.5 million Americans have fought in Iraq and Afghanistan since 2001.
You forget how different the world is over here.
As a nation, we thank our veterans for their service. But few of us really know what war is like, or how hard it is to return to a normal life after facing danger, suffering, and death. I want to change that. I want you to meet some people that I know and admire.
Did you feel like you left healed?
I left physically healed.
My name is Wes Moore. I served in Afghanistan. I'm doing this project to preserve a moment in time. We're capturing photos, portraits of veterans as they share their stories of reentry to civilian life.
There's no earthly reason why I should be alive.
They represent a new generation of warriors.
I'd look in the mirror and be mad at it.
It's not fair.
I want you to see them for who they really are, to know why it is that some struggle and many succeed.
Four men gave their lives for me to do something with mine.
Hearing and honoring what they have done and are doing. They have served our nation in battle, and they are rejoining the society they fought to defend.
Tuesday night at 8 on MPT.
On Masterpiece Mystery.
Those stars, huge stars.
You're dead.
I come back, baby.
They're reforming the band.
Are we good?
Better than good.
We could be again.
Not if one of you's a murderer.
Inspector Lewis on Masterpiece Mystery.
Friday night at 10:30 on MPT.
MPT's regularly scheduled program will not be seen so that we may bring you this special presentation.
Tonight, Decision 2014, the first televised live debate with the Democratic candidates and the race for governor in Maryland. Lieutenant Governor Anthony Brown, Maryland State Delegate Heather Mizier, and Attorney General Doug Gansler. Live from the Clary Smith Performing Arts Center at the University of Maryland College Park, here's David Gregory, moderator of NBC's Meet the Press.
And good evening, I'm David Gregory. Welcome to the Maryland gubernatorial debate among the Democratic candidates, Lieutenant Governor Anthony Brown, Delegate Heather Mazier, and Attorney General Doug Gansler, hosted by the University of Maryland, NBC4, and Bowie State University. This debate is also airing on WHAG in Hagerstown, Maryland, Maryland Public Television, and streaming live on NBCWashington.com. I want to begin by quickly going over the rules of tonight's debate, their rules, the candidates' debate. The debate will last 1 hour. We'll begin with 1-minute-long opening statements from each candidate. The order has already been determined during a random drawing. Then our panelists and I will pose questions directly to the candidates. These are questions determined by NBC News and NBC4. The panelists have not reviewed the questions, nor has the University of Maryland. I am also in the role of timekeeper here. I've got so many accoutrements to help me measure the time, so I'll be keeping everybody to time. Each candidate is going to have 1 minute to respond. As moderator, I'll also be allowed to follow up with questions or provide a 30-second rebuttal to the candidates as necessary. Finally, the debate will conclude with closing statements. A timekeeper will be located in the front row of the audience facing the candidates. The timekeeper will notify candidates of their remaining time and when time has expired. In the interest of trying to cover as much ground as possible, we've asked the candidates to adhere to these time limits. Politicians always keep to time, come on. And we also ask that the audience listen quietly. No applause, please, over the course of this, no shouting during the debate. Now I want to welcome our panelists tonight. Chris Lawrence is a News 4 anchor. He spent the last decade covering some of the biggest national stories for CNN before joining the NBC family. Chris is an alumnus of the University of Maryland here at College Park, so a welcome home for him. Chris, welcome.
Thank you.
Jenna Johnson writes about Maryland politics, including the General Assembly and the 2014 election for the Washington Post. She has been with the Post since 2007. Finally, Chris Gordon, a lawyer. He has been a reporter in this area for almost 3 decades, and for more than 15 years, he's covered Maryland politics and legal issues across the state for NBC4. And now, please welcome the Democratic candidates for governor, the Attorney General of Maryland, Doug Gansler, Maryland State Delegate Heather Mazier, and Lieutenant Governor Anthony Brown. Attorney General Gansler, you will be first with your one minute, opening statement, so the floor is yours.
Thank you, David. Thank you, University of Maryland, Bowie State, and NBC for hosting this debate this evening. As your governor, I will continue to do what I've done for the past 22 years in public service, and that's when I see something that's unfair or wrong, I will fight relentlessly to solve the problem and get things done. Whether it's bringing the Beltway snipers to justice, arguing in front of the Supreme Court of the United States to keep a child molester behind bars, suing Big Oil to clean up its spills, or preventing Big Tobacco from marketing cigarettes to our children. As your governor, I will give voice to the voiceless, making sure that every Marylander has access to health care, creating and strengthening the middle class by creating jobs, taking on the pollution lobby so we have clean air and a clean bay, and making sure that in every classroom we have skilled teachers for every student everywhere in Maryland. You see, I grew up in this state, and there's so much good about this state. But from jobs to health care to the environment, we can do so much more, and that's my fight.
And next up, thank you. Now, Delegate Mazier, your 1 minute opening statement.
Thank you, David. When I was 9 years old, the factory where my father was a union welder went on strike for fair wages. And over the next 6 months, my family and I struggled to live on $45 a week strike pay. During that period of time, my father took me with him to the picket lines where I got to see firsthand men and women standing up for what they believe in with incredible courage. I have remembered this my entire time in Annapolis, standing up for Maryland families. I've expanded health insurance to 50,000 more children in our state, passed bipartisan legislation to give thousands of low-income women access to free family planning services, and just last month, decriminalized the possession of marijuana. But for all of our successes, there are still too many families who are falling behind in our state. As your governor, I will create jobs with a living wage. reduce that income inequality gap, invest in our schools, and drive down violence in our neighborhoods with a smart on crime strategy. Together, we will deliver real results for Maryland families.
All right, thank you. Lieutenant Governor, please.
Thank you, David, and panelists, sponsors, and audience. Good evening. I'm a generation removed from poverty. My father was raised by his grandmother, my great-grandmother, in a one-bedroom home on a dirt floor in Kingston, Jamaica, poor neighborhood called Jonestown. And when my father was a little bit older than my son Jonathan is today, he wrote a letter to his mother, my grandmother, already in this country. He said, "Mom, bring me to America. I want to be a doctor. I want to heal people." She wasn't a wealthy woman, a woman without an education, but knew the importance of an education. So she saved her money, brought my father, her son, to this country. He was the first in our family to get a college education. My father spent a lifetime as a family doctor treating people and serving people, even those who couldn't pay for his services. When I grew up, I knew I wanted to be just like my father. I didn't go to medical school, but I had the privilege to serve our country in the Army, then in the House of Delegates, and for the last 8 years as your Lieutenant Governor. Together, we will build a better Maryland for more Marylanders, and I look forward to doing that with each and every one of you.
All right, thank you all very much. Let's talk about the issues. I'm going to start. Healthcare is something that Americans are concerned about across the board, especially with the Affordable Care Act. I'm going to ask this question to three of you in the order that was designed, so I'll start with you, Attorney General Gansler. It is widely argued by you and others and believed that the rollout of the healthcare exchange here in Maryland was a disaster. Who ultimately is accountable for that? What is the impact of it, and how would you fix it?
Well, thank you, David. The Lieutenant Governor for a number of years has touted that he is in charge of the Affordable Care Act rollout. In fact, right now, if you look on his website, it says that Maryland has led the country in the Affordable Care Act rollout. The Washington Post, the Baltimore Sun, Senator Mikulski, and many others have called it a national disaster. I think the Lieutenant Governor is the only person that believes it's been a success. We're actually 45th in the country in terms of people enrolled, so that's relatively delusional. We've taken $200 million of taxpayer money and on a website that was broken and flushed it down the toilet. And the tragedy is that real people can't get diabetes screening, health care for their children, heart disease medication. And of course, for somebody who co-chaired President Obama's campaign here in Maryland and went to the United States Supreme Court and had Maryland's lead plaintiff on the Affordable Care Act constitutionality, it gives the Republicans a chance to attack our president for doing something that no other president was able to do, which is make the United States, like every other industrialized country in the world,
all right, Attorney
health care to its citizens.
You're out of time. Who's ultimately responsible? Who's accountable for this?
Well, the Lieutenant Governor. He's under his own... under his own recognition. He said, this is literally the one thing that he's been in charge of, that he's managed or he's led since he was Lieutenant Governor, and it's been an unmitigated disaster.
All right, the Lieutenant Governor will have a moment to respond in full in just a moment when we come to you, but Delegate Mazier, same question to you. Who's ultimately accountable for this? What would you do to fix it?
David, I'm not about casting blame. I'm about fixing the problem and making sure that families get access to the health care that they deserve. I have spent a lifetime making sure that people have access to affordable, quality health care. I believe that health care is a right, not a privilege. I have been a strong supporter of the Affordable Care Act from the beginning because, as a delegate, I had been working in our state for years to get many of those same provisions passed in our state. The first piece of legislation that I passed was a bill that allowed young adults to remain on their family's health plans until they're 25. That's now federal law because we showed how it worked in Maryland first. And I learned in passing bills to give 50,000 more children health insurance or getting women access to free family planning services, that what matters most is that reforms are implemented effectively. Our ideas and our vision matter in this election, but our records of management matter even more. You want a governor with a successful track record of implementing health reforms, okay. And I am that leader.
Lieutenant Governor, are you ultimately accountable for this?
David, as I've said on numerous occasions, everyone involved with establishing the health benefits exchange is responsible, and that includes me. I'm not new to health care. For the last 8 years, we have expanded health care to over 500,000 Marylanders who didn't have access before. So when we set out to implement the Affordable Care Act, just like the president with the difficulties in the federal website and the difficulties they had on the launch, so too did we in Maryland. And I sincerely regret that any Marylander was inconvenienced trying to get health care through the broken website. But nobody was more frustrated than me. And that's why I took the action that I did. I reorganized the leadership at the exchange. The executive director left. We refocused the vendors, fired those who didn't perform as promised, including IBM. And after evaluating the resources and capabilities at the exchange, we plussed up the call centers and the navigators. And the result, David, 330,000 Marylanders now with access to affordable
quality. But let me follow up on this. You heard the Attorney General say the amount of money that is going to chase after this mistake. You're about 50% behind where you'd like to be in getting people enrolled. On the national level, this was an issue in terms of getting those young, healthy people to pay attention, ultimately, and to sign up for something that they think is broken. How do you deal with that?
Well, let's give the benchmark first. The benchmark is our goal in Maryland was 260,000. We enrolled 330,000. 260 in Medicaid. Now, Medicaid's important. You know, for better or for worse, you like it or not, in America, Medicaid is the health insurance for the working poor. So we've expanded health insurance to Maryland's poor and working families, 260,000, but a total of 330. So today, in order to ensure that we have a seamless transition for the open enrollment in November, we're adopting proven technology in Connecticut.
Let me give 30 seconds to the Attorney General in a rebuttal to this.
Well, there's a couple things. First of all, the actual number that we know that was able to sign up through the website was through Jenna Johnson's article. The last we've heard was four people. And that is because there's been a cover-up from the special interest that doesn't want us to know what happened. So what they then did, they went into a closed room and decided they were going to chase good money after bad and spend another $60 million to get the Connecticut exchange to come down here and try and retrofit it. Even the Connecticut people say it won't work. But we certainly won't know if it'll work if we don't find out what happened in the first place to the $200 million.
We're going to keep the conversation going with Chris Lawrence, moving on to another topic.
Yeah, the decriminalization of marijuana has a lot of people in Maryland wondering what's the next step and if that includes legalizing marijuana. Yet the governor of one of the most progressive states in this country has recently raised some serious concerns about that issue. California's Jerry Brown says, quote, if there's advertising and legitimacy, how many people can get stoned and still have a great state or a great nation? My question to all of you is the money that the state could get from taxing this drug worth accepting it in Maryland? And I'd like to begin with Delegate Mazier.
Thank you for the question. Our marijuana prohibition laws have been a failure. They have been enforced with racial bias. African Americans and whites in our state use marijuana with the exact same frequency, but African Americans go to jail three times more often. That's why I fought for decriminalization this session. We're not putting 23,000 people in jail anymore because of their nonviolent possession of this drug. We're not spending $280 million a year on the incarceration, detention, and court costs associated with this. But if we legalize, tax, and regulate marijuana, not only are we bringing in a new revenue source that I dedicate to paying for a universal pre-K program, but we would also be sending an important message about the fact that this is a substance that is arguably less harmful to the body than alcohol and tobacco. And for adults, it should be treated the same way. For youth, we have to step in and make sure they don't have access. And there are no campaigns right now to keep marijuana out of the hands of our youth. What drug dealer cards for an ID? I have a plan to spend $4 million a year to make sure that young people don't have access
to this. Lieutenant Governor.
Thank you, David. Look, Heather and I agree on a number of issues and disagree on probably a fewer number. I don't agree with Delegate Mazur's call for legalization at this time. I think there are two states that are looking at it. We ought to be looking at not just the money, but the socioeconomic effects. But I do agree with Delegate Mazur in the decriminalization of possession of small amounts of marijuana. We spend over $100 million in this state prosecuting possession of small amounts, and that could go to prosecuting more violent crime. Also, as just pointed out, disproportionately African-American, particularly African-American young men, are arrested at higher rates, yet consumption rates are in the same in this country. But I fundamentally disagree with the values of the Attorney General when it comes to rooting out racist practices in the criminal justice system. I oppose the death penalty, and I fought long and hard to repeal it in Maryland. The Attorney General supports it, says it's a wonderful tool. He says it's reliable for convictions, but studies have shown it's not reliable. It disproportionately impacts African Americans, and it doesn't deter crime.
Attorney General, take 30 seconds to respond to that particular point before you answer Chris's question.
Well, it's curious that he says he's fought for years, because every time the repeal of the death penalty bill came up while he was a delegate in Annapolis, other delegates signed up to sponsor the bill, and the lieutenant governor was nowhere to be found until he was running for governor. The death penalty is a lot like prohibition. It's a non-issue in this campaign. The General Assembly has repealed it. The public has spoken on it. I've been a prosecutor for 22 years, and I never sought the death penalty once.
So let's talk about marijuana then.
As a former assistant United States attorney in the Clinton administration, state's attorney in Montgomery County, now attorney general, I understand the ravages that drugs do cause families and the addictions and what they do to people. I happen to agree that medical marijuana is something we should allow to have, as long as it's being prescribed by real doctors. And decriminalization is someplace we should have gone. I don't think, though, and I agree with the Lieutenant Governor, that we should go to legalization right now. Former Attorney General Brown of California is right. We have to make sure we allow some of these states to see how it works. Marijuana hasn't been legal for hundreds of years. Let's see how it works. There's no rush. Iron out any of the problems. But we shouldn't be motivated by taxes when we do it. We should make sure that if we are going to legalize marijuana, and hopefully that won't happen for a long time, we do it in lockstep with public safety officials and public health officials, because we shouldn't be motivated by having yet another tax on a product. Now, I can say the decriminalization is for such small amounts that very few people are locked up on that amount.
Delegate Mazur, just a final 30 seconds on this. With legalization in your views, are you comfortable saying to the children of this state, marijuana is okay?
We're not saying that to the children of this state. To the children of this state, we're saying that it's a very dangerous substance for a developing mind, and we're going to spend $4 million a year to make sure that they understand that. But what drug dealer is carding for an ID right now? That's how kids are getting access. And when we legalize, tax, and regulate it, the state's in charge of this. And the same way we do with alcohol, we improve our chances of keeping it out of the hands of our youth. The Institute of Medicine actually said that the gateway drug theory is about the drug, about marijuana being prohibited, that the laws against it are what actually has young people having more access.
To Chris Gordon now.
There is a perception that Maryland is not business friendly. You may have heard it. I have, on the street. And there are four Republican candidates running for the same job you are, who say that taxes have been raised and created dozens and dozens of times in the last 7 years of this administration. And they're going to blame Democratic lawmakers. So my question to you, in fact, they want to reduce or do away with some of those taxes. So would you lower or raise taxes? And how do you attract business and new jobs to the state?
Lieutenant.
Lieutenant
Governor first.
Lieutenant Governor Brown.
Look, as I've traveled around the state and spoke with business leaders from all four corners, there is concern about the business climate in Maryland, and I've rolled out a proposal to position Maryland to be the most competitive business climate state in the nation. Part of it is looking at regulations and licensing, and part of it is looking at our tax liability. Look, in the first 100 days of the Brown-Ohman campaign, we are going to put together a Blue Ribbon Commission to look at tax reform. We're going to make sure that we're giving relief to working families, that we're incentivizing employers to invest in job-creating activities in Maryland, and that we're protecting our investments in education, public safety, the environment, and health care. But my tax plan will not include, and it doesn't, the corporate giveaway under the Gansler corporate tax giveaway. If we're going to invest in education, if we're going to invest in transportation, we can't afford to give a small number of the largest corporations in Maryland a $1.6 billion tax giveaway. It's under that plan that Doug has said we can't fund pre-K education for all Maryland four-year-olds.
That's not my plan. Attorney General is the same question.
Thank you, Chris. It's not a perception, it's a reality. We have had 40 consecutive tax increases here in Maryland. The people of Maryland just can't take it anymore. We've had 76% more people unemployed than when the Lieutenant Governor came to power, when he's been at the seat of power and stood by when all this was happening to our state. In Baltimore City, 46% of the adult males don't have work. We've lost over 7,000 small businesses in the last 8 years. We're 43rd in the country in manufacturing, and we only have four Fortune 500 companies left here in Maryland, which is one of the richest states and one of the smartest states in the country in terms of advanced degrees. So we cannot continue to mortgage mortgage the economic viability and future of this state on the backs of casino gambling and more tax increases. We need to bring life science companies here, cybersecurity companies here. We need to look at what New York has done in terms of manufacturing and having tax-free incentives to manufacturers so people can once again get back to work in the state of Maryland, because we can't continue to have half a billion or do billion-dollar deficits every year in Annapolis.
Delegate Mazeer.
I'm the only one on this stage that has owned a small business, and I'm the only one with a plan to help them grow. I have a different vision about our economy, one that doesn't pit workers against businesses. My job creation strategy includes something for us all. If we were to bring back the millionaire's tax and close one corporate tax loophole that allows a handful of companies in our state that operate in other states who are avoiding paying their fair share of Maryland taxes, just ask them to pay their fair share, we could generate enough revenue to give 90% of all Maryland families a tax cut and tax relief for all of our small businesses. If we put more money in the hands of middle-class families, what do? They spend it in the economy. They go out to eat at more restaurants. They buy more shoes for their children or school supplies. And I have a plan to put people to work rebuilding our roads, our transit, and building 21st century schools.
All right, to Jenna Johnson now.
Great. Violent crime is down across the state, except for one category, forcible rape. In 2012, more than 1,200 people reported being raped in Maryland, and advocates say even more cases go unreported. The Obama administration has launched several initiatives aimed at reducing and combating sexual violence in the military and on college campuses. What will you do here in Maryland to address sexual violence? And Attorney General, we'll start with you.
Thank you. We're actually the ninth most violent state in the country. Baltimore City is the seventh most violent city in the country, and we have the fourth most homicides in the country here in Maryland. So we have a lot of work to do. In terms of rape, let me talk about Hollis Church for a moment. She was raped while watching television in Kensington one night. 13 years later, I was able to personally go into court and prosecute the offender because we had a DNA hit from Virginia. We then went to the Supreme Court of the United States when I was Attorney General and made sure we upheld the DNA statute so that law enforcement could use DNA to solve cold case rape cases. So we do have an issue here in Maryland, and we need to do a lot more in terms of our crime prevention and going forward. We need community prosecution. We need to make sure that a lot of the rapes actually happen in domestic violence situations, and I started the first domestic violence court in Montgomery County. We want to have domestic violence courts all over the state when I'm governor.
Delegate Mazeer.
Any woman who has faced rape or domestic violence deserves to know that she has a governor and the law on her side. I have been pushing to erase the backlog of rape kits that are sitting in our criminal justice system. I have a plan to make sure that we remove guns from the scenes of domestic violence disputes, because we know that women are five times more likely to be hurt, harmed, killed even, when their abuser has a firearm in the home. And I've been pushing for paid sick leave that includes time off for safe time for women who need to interact with the criminal justice system, work to get a restraining order, or meet with an attorney to get the protection that she needs. We have to make sure that we protect and empower women, that we bring their abusers to justice, and that we do everything we can to make sure that this violence isn't repeated again. I'll be the governor that helps get this done.
Lieutenant Governor?
You know, we'll build stronger communities on the foundation of stronger families, when our wives, our mothers, our sisters, and our daughters can live free of the fear of sexual assault, rape, and domestic violence in the home, in the neighborhood, and in the workplace. No family is immune from that type of violence. My cousin Kathy was killed at the hands of her estranged boyfriend. And since that time, and even before, I've worked with the advocates of domestic violence. We've increased the number of domestic violence referral programs and sexual assault units at our community hospitals from 4 to 9. And my goal is to reach every one of the 43 community hospitals in the state of Maryland. Together, we've done a lot of work to reduce domestic violence against women, to make this a safer state for women. We've given judges the authority to order domestic abusers to surrender their firearms. This year, finally, after 19 years of failed effort, we lowered the standard, and a woman can now get a protective order on a preponderance of the evidence standard instead of the heightened, clear, and convincing standard. So we're making a lot of progress. We have a lot more work to do.
Back to Chris Gordon.
All right, this question deals with character, leadership, and fitness for office. You've all had public service. We thank you for that. And I'm going to ask you each an individual question to answer here. Attorney General Gansler, your judgment has been questioned. With the pictures that we have seen from the party you attended, where your son was at, where there may have been underage drinking, and you said you did nothing to stop it, it was not in Maryland, it was in Delaware. With your statements, military service you implied was not a real job. And with your use of a state car, a report being that you asked your state detail to go through red lights or up the shoulder of a road to get you to an appointment on time. Lieutenant Governor Brown, we have heard tonight that you botched the rollout, and in fact, the Attorney General used the word cover-up tonight. And Delegate Mazier, critics say that you're just not experienced enough because you've been a state delegate since 2007, but you've never had statewide elected office or experience as an executive. How do you all answer these critics? Delegate Mazier, we start with you.
Marylanders want a governor who knows how to bring people together to get big things done. Let me tell you two stories about the way I've done this on family planning and marijuana decriminalization. I reached across the aisle to work with the head of the Tea Party caucus to expand family planning services to low-income women by first convincing him that it lowered the abortion rate and saved the state money. It also happens to be good for maternal and child health outcomes. Together, we put partisanship on the shelf in order to make progress for our state. 34,000 more women have access to free family planning services in our state because of this. This year in the legislative session, with just 48 hours to go, the press all reported that our marijuana decriminalization effort was dead. It had got voted out of a committee and turned into a study bill. I worked with the Legislative Black Caucus and a group of progressive legislators to come up with a strategy on the floor to turn that around. We passed that law, sent it to the governor's desk. Maryland is now the 18th state to decriminalize marijuana. Both of these happen because of leadership.
Time.
I'm the governor that this state is ready for.
Lieutenant Governor, what about the criticism, your
sure.
The leadership quietness, the fitness question?
Sure. As governor, I would bring not only 8 years of experience as lieutenant governor, but 8 years in the General Assembly and 30 years in uniform and service to our country. As Lieutenant Governor, during the last 8 years, I led the effort on Bay Street alignment and closure that has already to date created or brought to our state 49,000 jobs, and we are well on our way to meeting the goal of 60,000 jobs by 2022. Reduce violence against women and children and the work we're doing on domestic violence that I've had the opportunity to lead and work with so many on. We've reduced the number of children in foster care from 9,000 to 6,900. I've led on that effort as well as the work we've done to serve our veterans. Marylanders have a choice. They're going to look at experience, they're going to look at record, and they're going to look at judgment. Not only, Chris, the things that you offered up to the Attorney General, but also the fact that he was the only state's attorney in the history of Maryland reprimanded by the highest court for misconduct, ethical misconduct in office, because he denied a defendant the right to a fair trial because he, for political gain, spoke out. That's judgment. Voters are going to be looking at that.
Attorney General, you can respond to that as well as the question that Chris originally posed.
Start with the reprimand?
I'd like to, yeah. Since it just...
Yes, I had the honor of being reprimanded by the Court of Appeals because I took on a judge who said to an 11-year-old girl who was raped by a sexual internet predator that it takes two to tango, and it was her fault for responding to his emails, which is why he went and raped her. The Court of Appeals then reprimanded me for being a public official publicly reading a public charging document at a press conference with the police. I wear it as a badge of honor. As far as character, I think my character stands for itself. I've been in public office for 22 years representing the victims of crime. I've taken on cases, for example, Garrett Wilson, who murdered both of his babies in the 1980s, and they ruled his SIDS death. Nobody else would prosecute that case. I did, and he's spending the rest of his life behind bars. There were children in Baltimore City who didn't have access to the same things that the rest of Maryland did to be able to play lacrosse. So 6 years ago, I cared about them, so I started a league called Charm City Youth Lacrosse. We have over 400 boys and girls in that league right now that are all prospering and being able to go to better schools and being active in their communities. Let me talk about the beach party, because
You're over on your time, but I'm going to ask you, you have 30 seconds. I'm going to ask you about that. Did you miss an opportunity as the Attorney General of the state to deal, as the Attorney General, with underage drinking? Did you miss an opportunity as a parent to step into that situation and not put blinders on, but deal with it more responsibly?
So my wife and I have been married for 22 years. We are profoundly proud of our children. That night I went to tell my child what time he was going to leave the next morning. Could I have done something different there that night? Absolutely. Well, will we say things to our children or do things in the future that we could do differently? Absolutely. As a matter of fact, a few weeks later, I took him to college at Penn. And is there underage drinking at college? Absolutely. I'm not going to not send them to college, but we worry. We parent on the fly. And that was the mistake we made that night. In terms of Attorney General, I led the nation in taking caffeinated alcoholic beverages off the shelves.
All right. We are going to leave it there for a moment. We are going to take a break here, take a pause for a brief commercial break. We'll be right back with many more questions for the candidates for governor of Maryland. And after the debate, join me for a special Google Hangout on NBCWashington.com. We'll be right back.
Maryland Public Television's broadcast of the WRC debate from the University of Maryland College Park will continue shortly. Coming up on June 2nd, the Democrats will debate again live in MPT studios. That debate airs at 7 p.m. On June the 6th, MPT will broadcast a debate featuring the Republican candidates for governor, also at 7 o'clock. Tonight's debate continues right after this.
Thousands of sharks hunt along the volcanic reefs of this tiny island in the Pacific. Acclaimed filmmaker Howard Hall and his crew have been diving in these waters for more than a decade.
Now, this may not be entirely safe.
Woo, look at those big boys.
There's 50 sharks down there.
Go.
Yeah, go. Yeah, go.
No.
Push them in.
Welcome to Shark Mountain, next time on Nature.
Tonight at 8 on MPT.
Next time on Nazi Mega Weapons, the incredible story of a revolutionary jet fighter.
It's so sleek. It's a thing of wonder.
And the amazing factories where it was brought to life.
This is a very impressive example of Nazi engineering. It's almost exactly like a Bond villain's lair.
Tonight at 10 on MPT.
Look what we found on Chesapeake Collectibles.
This is a treasure trove.
And it was going in the trash.
The dial is marked Tiffany & Company.
I never expected to receive a letter. This has their three signatures on it.
You are exactly right about the exceptional quality.
Well, if this is your first attempt, I'm definitely going art shopping with you.
I'm shocked.
It's all next time on Chesapeake Collectibles.
Thursday night at 8 on MPT.
Next time on Doc Martin.
You're the only man who's ever written me a poem.
Edith may still have feelings for Martin. Things aren't going well now that Pauline lives with Al and Bert.
If you're not careful, she's going to leave you too personal.
How do you know?
Because she told me not to tell you.
PC Penhale's big brother is in town.
Can you see the family likeness?
No.
And Pauline likes him.
Have you ever done a nude?
Doc Martin.
Thursday night at 9 on MPT.
And we are back live at the Clarice Smith Performing Arts Center at the University of Maryland with three Democratic candidates for Governor of Maryland, Attorney General Doug Gansler, Delegate Heather Mazier, and Lieutenant Governor Anthony Brown. Before we move back to the panel, I want to just stay for a moment, Lieutenant Governor, on this leadership and character question. You heard the Attorney General respond to questions about that beach party. Firstly, is that a character issue for you in this race? And secondly, how did you respond to his comment about your military record?
Well, I think it's a judgment issue. And the set of rules that apply to the public apply to us. If it was one thing, if it were perhaps in your own living room with your children. But months earlier, you looked into the camera, you told parents what we know. We are the role models to discourage underage drinking. You did a public service announcement. But then found yourself in the middle of not one, two, or three, but literally hundreds of teenagers underage drinking. And what I would have done as a parent, and I too am a parent, my 19-year-old daughter sitting right here in the audience,
okay,
I would have stopped the party and made sure that every child got home safely.
All right, take 30 seconds, Attorney General.
Well, as much as I appreciate the Lieutenant Governor lecturing me on my parenting skills, I would like to talk about the military question that you just asked. To be clear, I did not say one derogatory syllable to any one of our veterans. Like everybody watching at home and everybody here, I have the deepest respect for our veterans and a profound depth of gratitude toward them. But we can do so much more for our veterans in Maryland. During the 8 years, we haven't stepped up. We could get them PTSD counseling. We have the worst Veterans Administration office in the country here in Maryland. And we need to make sure that we don't tax their retirement income here
quickly,
in Maryland.
Quickly, Lieutenant Governor, respond to that since you were the...
You can't build a strong Maryland if you keep cutting it down. And right now, we have a honorable veteran community that is well served by the Maryland Department of Veterans Affairs. These are veterans that are serving veterans. Post-traumatic stress disorder. The work that we're doing to connecting them to jobs. We're proud of the work that we do, and we're proud of the service that they perform both here in the community and we're in service. Whether you're a cook, a clerk, a lawyer, a pilot, or anything else in the military, we value your service to our nation.
Delegate Mazzier, let me give you 30 seconds on this issue.
David, you asked about leadership and character. I don't think it's about this kind of personal bickering and attacks. Voters are wanting candidates to remain positive and stay focused on the issues. Leadership and character that we need in Annapolis is a governor that will take on the special interests and fight for middle-class families. And that is who I am, that's who I've always been, and that's what you can expect me to do as your governor.
All right, Jenna, back to you.
So we recently heard a recording that was reportedly the owner of the LA Clippers making racist comments. The NBA has since banned him for life. And President Obama responded by saying, quote, "We constantly have to be on guard on racial attitudes that divide us rather than embracing our diversity as a strength." Here in Maryland, the owner of the Redskins has said that the team name celebrates Native American culture, while others have said it's an offensive racial slur. Is it a slur, and should it be changed? And Lieutenant Governor, we'll start with you.
Sure. First of all, let me say that what the NBA did in response to the comment by the owners of the LA Clippers was appropriate, and it sends a strong signal that those words, that action, is unacceptable. I no longer refer to Washington's football team by their nickname. I do find it offensive, and I would hope that the owner, Dan Snyder, would reach the same conclusion and to change the name. I believe that the fan base wants the same thing, but more importantly, if we're going to live up to the kind of Maryland that we can all be proud of, then we have to synchronize our words, our actions, okay? And Dan Snyder, if his football team particularly is playing in Maryland, he ought to synchronize his conscience, his actions, and do the right thing and change the name.
Attorney General.
Thank you. I started the first civil rights division in our state's history in the Attorney General's office. We've taken on the minority achievement gap in higher education. I'm extremely concerned about the lack of funding for our HBCUs here in Maryland. We've addressed voting rights issues. So I'm keenly aware of this issue involving civil rights and people that feel discriminated against. You know, in terms of the Redskins, I've been a lifelong Redskins fan. I do a show every week before the game for the Redskins. And I am sympathetic to those fans that deeply love the name and understand that it wasn't intended as a slur, but it is. And so we should move toward changing the name away from the Redskins because people find it offensive. We changed the name of the Bullets when people found that offensive. And look at tonight, the Wizards are playing right up against this debate, and hopefully they're winning. And so we can change the name and move on. And I think that if people are offended by it, we actually should change the name. And the Redskins owners will make a lot more money by selling throwback jerseys and the like.
If they don't, though, if you were governor of this state, would you pursue some recourse to put pressure on the team to do it, pressure on the NFL to do it?
You know, I think not. I think I would meet with Mr. Snyder and people from the Redskins organization and try and come to an understanding. I think they're going to change the name. I think that the die is cast, and I think they're going to change the name. The question is when and how.
Delegate Mazzier.
Words matter, and I am opposed to the name of the Washington Redskins, and I've made that clear over the course of this election. But our actions matter even more. Let's talk about the income inequality gap that exists in our state. We raised the minimum wage this year, but it was so watered down by the time we pushed it through that the next governor will be running for re-election before it even gets to 1010. And we didn't include provisions that indexed it for inflation or addressed the problem of our tipped workers still only earning $3.63 an hour. Many of those workers are women and people of color. If you look at our gender pay gap in this state, women are still making, on average, 85 cents on the dollar to their male counterparts. But if you're an African-American woman, that's 67 cents. If you're a Latina woman, it's 46 cents. This is an issue of urgency that demands a governor that cares about these issues and will fight to address the income inequality gap, that has plans to provide minimum wage relief. I want to not just have a minimum wage.
Time.
I want to have a living wage. And I'm the only candidate up here that has put that policy on the table.
To Chris Lawrence.
As a father of two very young children, I want to ask a question about schools, which is something that's very, very important to a lot of Maryland moms and Maryland dads out there. Just down the road from here, Montgomery County's enrollment has grown by about 15,000 students just since the year 2000. The county educates more than 17% of Maryland students, and yet it only receives about 11% of school construction funds. My question is, will you work to change the current funding mechanism for Maryland schools to steer more money to Montgomery County? And let's start with Delegate Mazur.
Thank you for the question. It's a really critical one. I got involved in this issue 3 years ago as Vice Chair of Education and Economic Development for our Appropriations Committee. I was touring schools in Baltimore City. I was in Hollabird Academy, and I was devastated by what I saw. Fountains that the kids can't drink out of because they're lead piped. They're too cold in their rooms with coats taking their exams because the heat doesn't work. I've seen prison conditions better than these schools. Now, I could have come home to Montgomery County and said, that's Baltimore's problem. But I recognize that Baltimore's problem was the most acute. $3 billion problem of what is a $15 billion crisis for the entire state. We had to fix it in Baltimore first before we could fix it anywhere else. And I was really proud to be involved in getting that first round of funding put together. It's a model we can use to bring funding to Montgomery County, Baltimore County, and Prince George's County, which we fought to get done this legislative session. And as governor, I'll get it done. I have a plan in my jobs and economic development plan that has two more ideas on how we can get that money. You'll have to read about it on my website.
Who's up next on this?
It should be the Attorney General.
It's Brown, Lieutenant General. Okay. Lieutenant Governor, excuse me.
Me?
Yes.
Okay,
yes,
time. Look, over the last 7 years, we've built, according to Education Week magazine, some of the best schools in the nation. We rank number one. But I think everyone understands and believes, and I'm certainly committed to ensuring that every child, whether you're educated in Bethesda, Chevy Chase, or in Baltimore City, has access to a world-class education in a modern, technology-ready classroom. That's why over the last 8 years, we've increased investments in school construction at a high watermark of $400 million, an average of $340 million a year. That's not enough. I put forward a plan in December. So over the next 4 years, we will increase that average to $500 million a year. I'm committed to working with the local leadership in Montgomery County to do exactly what we did in Baltimore County. We authorized a $1.1 billion school construction program to get those children out of the second oldest set of schools in the state. We can do that. We have the resources in Maryland. It's not going to be easy. We have to set our priorities. In a Brown-Ullman administration, schools are top priority.
To the Attorney General.
I grew up in Montgomery County. I'm a proud graduate of the Chevy Chase Elementary School. My family lives in Montgomery County, so I actually know what Montgomery County is like. And it's not like what much of the state believes it to be like. We're a majority-minority county. We have 166 languages spoken in our schools. And to your question, we are woefully underfunded. Baltimore City needed new schools, and they got $1 billion toward that. But Montgomery County, Prince George's County, and Baltimore County deserve to have new schools, too. But not only that, the lieutenant governor has been in office for 8 years in the seat of power and stood by while Maryland has the number two number two minority achievement gap in the country, the second worst, and that's the moral stain of our state. So we need to address that. I was the first candidate to come out for expanding pre-K for all people in Maryland, particularly starting with people 300% above the poverty line and below. But we also have to make sure we have skilled teachers, like in every other profession, reward the people who are most esteemed, which is our teachers.
Time, Lieutenant Governor, take 30 seconds for rebuttal.
Thank you, 30 seconds. Maryland leads the nation when it comes to reducing the achievement gap by income, and we have work to do. Our students of color are making the greatest progress in fourth grade and eighth grade math and reading. We still have an achievement gap to close. That's why I have a plan. Doug, you talk about a moral stain in education and achievement gap. If we pass the Gansler corporate tax giveaway, that moral stain will become an indelible blemish as generations of students will not have access to early childhood education, which is proven to be one of the best ways to eliminate the achievement gap in education.
Attorney General, take 30 seconds to respond.
President Obama, Congressman Van Hollen, Congressman Hoyer, all for reducing the corporate tax. One of the reasons why we're losing so many of our companies to Virginia is because we have an 8.25% corporate tax and they have 6%. I was an economics major at Yale. I get the people operate on their best interests. If we reduce the corporate tax by 0.25% each year, more jobs will come, our tax base will be enhanced, and we'll be able to do things like fix the schools where we have this minority achievement gap. So we do need to, and I agree with Heather Mazur, we need to close that corporate loophole for the big companies.
Let me go back to Chris.
Call this the legacy question. The current governor, Martin O'Malley, had a very progressive list of priorities and passed most of them, if not all of them, the DREAM Act, lowering and making in-state tuition for the children of illegal immigrants, same-sex marriage, abolishing the death penalty, tough gun control laws. And this session is top priority, raising the minimum wage. So my question to each of you is, what's the next big idea you have? What would be your legacy if elected governor of Maryland? And we start with Delegate Mazur.
Actually, we're going to start with the Attorney General. We're watching this closely, so the Attorney General is here next.
Thanks for noticing. I was 5 years ahead of most people on the issue of marriage equality. I went down and testified on it before anybody else thought it was a good idea. They literally tried to impeach me in Annapolis. And, of course, my wife was hoping they would be successful so I'd get a real job. Here I am again as Attorney General running for yet a new job. I then wrote an opinion recognizing out-of-state same-sex marriages here in Maryland because I thought it was the right thing to do and I didn't think people should be discriminated against. I then was the first person on this stage to come out for increasing the minimum wage. It's just not fair. If you're making $7.25 an hour, working 40 hours a week, and you're still under the federal poverty line, that's just not right. So we need to, I think the next thing we need to do is bring jobs back to Maryland. We cannot sustain this. There's too many poor people. When you have 46% of the people in Baltimore, grown men, out of work, that's wrong. And the second is dealing with reentry, taking prisoners from behind bars and making them taxpaying citizens.
Delegate Mazur.
Thank you. I have a plan to make sure that we don't just have a minimum wage in this state, we have a living wage. Because no one should be working 40 hours a week and still be living in poverty. I have a plan to make sure that we address that achievement gap that we discussed earlier. It still matters in Maryland what your socioeconomic status is and what your race is to determine whether or not you're going to be successful in school. And we know it doesn't have to be that way. When we invest in early childhood initiatives from birth to age 5, we eliminate that disparity and give every child a chance to enter school ready to learn at the same pace. My plan to address this is comprehensive. It's a universal pre-K plan, not just for 4-year-olds, not just for 4-year-olds from some low-income families, all of our 4-year-olds, and we'll cover a half day for 3-year-olds as well. And we'll also provide child care subsidies, not just for low-income families who have a long waiting list to get access to care, but for middle-class families as well, because our children need access to quality, affordable, nurturing educational environment before they get into pre-K.
Lieutenant Governor.
Thank you, Chris. We live in a much more just society today than we did 8 years ago, passed marriage equality and the DREAM Act. We passed some of the most stringent gun safety measures in the wake of Newtown, Connecticut, and we repealed the death penalty. I believe that the greatest challenge that we face as a state and as a nation is to address the persistent, debilitating gaps, disparities, and inequities that exist in our economy, in our society, in our community, and yes, in our classrooms. And that's why I've got a plan to create more jobs in Maryland, but not only create more jobs by investments in infrastructure and renewable energy, but to educate and train all of Maryland's workforce so they can compete successfully for that. At the end of my four-year term, I hope that we can look back in Maryland and say, we have career technology education in every high school or every county so that we're not only preparing students who want to go to college, but those who don't so that they are ready to enter the workforce and support their
families. Final question here from Chris.
I want to talk a little bit about something that you all have brought up. Governor O'Malley has signed off on about 40 new taxes since he took office. And yet the number of Maryland families who need government help to make ends meet has reached record levels. And this is a very simple question. Would you raise taxes to cover the cost of continuing this level of government assistance? And I believe we go to the Lieutenant Governor first.
Thank you. Look, I think the good news is I don't see the need in the foreseeable future to have to raise taxes in Maryland. We've got the resources and the revenues to take on the tough challenges ahead, to fully fund education, to continue to drive down crime in neighborhoods throughout the state. I do believe that we ought to engage, as I said earlier, in comprehensive tax reform. Look, Maryland and America still has a level of poverty that is higher than it was when Dr. King was waging the war against poverty in the 1960s with Lyndon Johnson, President Johnson. That's why we've invested in Medicaid. That's why we've taken on a strategic goal to end childhood hunger. That's why we've expanded affordable housing, and I've got a plan to deliver even more affordable housing. Yeah, there are more demands, but Maryland's a great state, and Maryland can be better for more Marylanders if we apply our resources effective, wisely, in a socially prudent and fiscally responsible way.
Attorney General.
We've raised 40 straight taxes. People can't take it anymore. There's been a recent poll by Gallup that says 47% of Marylanders want to leave the state because of the tax burden and the economic hardship that we face. We need to actually bring jobs back. We need to focus on the fact that we are the only state in the country that has NIH and Johns Hopkins, number one hospital in the country, as well as the University of Maryland Medical System. We need to focus on the fact that we have the Cyber Command Center and the NSA here, and we have the smartest people in the country in terms of advanced degrees, yet we don't leverage that. And we need to bring manufacturing back to Maryland, and we need to make sure that Prince George's County has economic development around its transit-oriented development, because if we don't have jobs, we're going to continue to have poor people. There's nowhere to go. And so one of the things that we want to do is when you're 16 years old, there's some people that want to get a job. They don't want to stay in school until they're 18 and go the traditional path. So they'll have an ability to do a career and vocational and career apprenticeship where they can go to, in the afternoon, start to get certified. Time. So when 18, they can get a job.
Delegate Mazier.
Being governor is about setting priorities and building budgets around it. It's about revenues in and expenditures out. By decriminalizing marijuana, we've created another $280 million of savings in our budget. By legalizing and taxing it, we create another $160 million. When we close the corporate tax loophole that the handful of companies are abusing right now, $200 million extra in our state. Bring back the millionaire's tax, another $112 million. And what do you get for that? A universal pre-K program, tax cuts for small businesses, and 90% of all Maryland families get middle-class tax relief they have been begging for in this state. These are my priorities, and this is exactly how I will pay for them as your governor.
All right, to closing statements, Delegate Mazier, you're going to begin. You each have a minute. Please stick to time. We're tight on it. Go ahead. Okay.
I see it in living rooms and community centers all across this state. Voters want candidates who remain positive, who are focused on the policy and not platitudes, who remember that we're always going to be stronger when we put our common good ahead of the priorities of special interests and people who have extra access in Annapolis. I'm a governor that wants to make sure Maryland works for all of our citizens. I will invest in infrastructure needs for our state, make sure that our schools are great in every corner, reduce crime in our neighborhoods, and turn our minimum wage into a living wage. And for the women watching tonight, I know that for too long, the inequalities in our schools, in our pay, and in our economy have existed for too long. It doesn't have to be this way. I know what it takes to make Maryland work and be fair for all of Marylanders. And as your governor, I will get it done.
Lieutenant Governor, please.
Thank you, David. Over the last 8 years, we, and I say we collectively, have made tremendous progress as a state. We have built the best in the nation public schools, but we know that not every child's educated in a blue ribbon school today, so our work continues. We've not only driven crime down to the lowest levels we've seen in three decades, but we've reduced recidivism, and our inmate population is smaller today than it was 6 years ago. We're one of only a handful of states that weathered the Great Recession with a AAA bond rating. We recovered jobs at a rate faster than every state in the Mid-Atlantic, with an unemployment rate 1% below the national average. But we know that there continue to be Marylanders who are unemployed and underemployed. That's why I've got a plan, and I ask you to go to anthonybrown.com, because in this hour we didn't discuss all of it. I've got a 5-point plan to create jobs. I've got a plan to deliver universal pre-K to every Maryland 4-year-old, greater investments in career technology education, in school construction. But I need you. I need you to help me and Ken Ullman build a better Maryland for more Maryland.
To the Attorney General, closing thought.
You've heard a lot of back and forth this evening, and I want to end by sharing what motivates me, because during a political campaign, that does and can get distorted. Like you, my family motivates and defines me. Laura and I have been married for 22 years. We're profoundly proud of our children. We're incredibly devoted and involved parents, and I want them to be proud of our public service. And many families out there, you also motivate me, all the families I see around the state of Maryland, because we have taken on judges because of that. I have mentored inner city kids that the system has left behind. I've taken on polluters, cyberbullying, internet fraud, and internet crime. And when I'm governor, we will deliver the promise of health care reform, because health care is a right. So I just want to leave you with one thought, if there's one thought you can be left with, which is this. I will always stand up against the special interests, because your fight is my fight.
And we will leave it there. Thank you all very much. Thank you to our partners, University of Maryland, NBC4, Bowie State University.
Thousands of sharks hunt along the volcanic reefs of this tiny island in the Pacific. Acclaimed filmmaker Howard Hall and his crew have been diving in these waters for more than a decade.
Now, this may not be entirely safe.
Woo, look at those big boys.
There's 50 sharks down there.
Go.
Yeah, go. Yeah, go.
Yeah,
push them in.
Welcome to Shark Mountain, next time on Nature.
Tonight at 8 on MPT.
You're watching member-supported Maryland Public Television. Next time on Death in Paradise, a wealthy man is murdered on his private island. When the team investigates, a storm rolls in. And when they have to spend the night, they could be risking their lives.
So we're stranded here.
That means the killer is too.
Death in Paradise, Thursday night at 10:30 on MPT.
We came from Puerto Rico. We moved here to Bethlehem, Pennsylvania when I was 4 years old. I'd come from a very hardworking blue-collar family. My dad was diagnosed with leukemia. I couldn't continue my education and had to focus more on holding a full-time job so I could help pay the bills and support my family. I'm a very curious person. One night I was watching an episode of Nova about genetics and evolution. Fireworks went off in my head, thinking, oh yeah, that's something I could do. Why can't I go out and change the world? I decided to go back to school so I could study evolutionary genetics.